Good morning, everyone.
Good
to worship with you this morning. Let me just make another quick plug. If you have not had a chance to sign up on my sign-up sheet for kind of people who are willing to pray for me when I go out and work with churches, I send out emails to let you know when to pray. And if you would like to be on that list, I saw that looks like we got about 30 signatures out there, room for about 30 more. And somebody did come up laughing when I called that thing out there, the worship center, a bar. Sending Baptists to the bar is just such not a good thing, you know, but it is out there for you. And I think, again, there's one on the podium and one at the Welcome Center. So sign up if you meant to do that and forgot. That's out there for you again this week. I will be picking it up at the end of the service today and taking it home and making entries into my computer program to get you on that list. Well, I was speaking with a fellow about my age that had played Division I NCAA football, a linebacker, and we were having lunch together, and he had, in the last 7 years, had two shoulder replacements and two knee replacements, and he was looking at two hip replacements. All because of the pounding that his body took when he was playing football. So I asked him, I said, if you had it to do over again, knowing what you know now and the price you were going to pay later in life for what you did back then, would you do it again? And he looked at me straight in the eye and he said, absolutely. He said, those were the greatest years of my life. He said, to be a part of that team and to play with those guys, even if it cost me what it cost me. He said, I'd gladly do it again. And I just looked at him and I thought, what an idiot. How crazy is that? I mean, there's so much pain that we get in our lives that, you know, is unnecessary, or that is necessary, I guess, is the best way to put it, that comes upon us. Why would anyone invite more pain that is unnecessary? But he got me to thinking about the concept of good pain versus bad pain, because that's what he was describing. He decided that this was good pain. This was pain worth having if you got this experience out of it. And I think that concept is one that resonates with a lot of people, women particularly, who have borne children, know the pain that they have to go through in order to get a child. And although I remember my wife very clearly as she was giving birth to our son, right in the midst of those contractions, looking at me as I was holding her hand and telling her how to breathe, saying, you're having the next one. But the reality is that when the child is born, you think, to get this, would I go through that again? And most women would say, well, not right away, but yeah, it kind of loses its effect, and the idea of having a child at the end is a good thing. So it's good pain. Good pain versus bad pain. It's an interesting concept. And there are certain experiences that I think many of us can perhaps look back on and recognize that it left us with pain, but it was good pain. We'd go through it again if it was going to cost us what it cost us, because what we got out of it was so great, was so significant. And I want to look at a passage today which watches a guy go through pain, emotional and ultimately physical, but which we would, if we were to interview him, and I'll try and remember to bring that up at the end where we actually will ask him that question, and see what he would say, and I think we would figure out how he would view it at that point. This is a man named Jacob. And you'll find his story, the story we're going to focus on, in Genesis chapter 32. So if you have you've seen it on the screen, if you would turn there in your Bibles. This is really about the difference between unity and harmony. A lot of times we elevate the concept of unity in church contexts. But I think what God has done and what He seeks among us is not unity. Two cats with their tails tied together and hung over a clothesline have unity. But they don't have harmony. And I think what God is seeking among His people is not just unity. It's harmony. And harmony requires something else to take place in the human heart for that to be achieved, where people become of one mind and of one spirit, where they are on the same wavelength together. Harmony. And it takes work to achieve that, kind of work that you guys have been doing, like you did on Saturday. To work through things that perhaps we have unity about, but we have not had harmony about. So Jacob, and Jacob's an interesting character. I mean, when he was born, his parents looked at him and said, his name is rip-off artist. That's what Jacob means. Your child be born, we're going to name him rip-off artist. But his name means supplanter. It means somebody who takes what doesn't belong to them, cons people out of stuff. That's what the name itself means. And Jacob grew up with this kind of he came to almost reflect what his name described. Some of you may know the story, but before we talk about it together, I want to just pause. Get our hearts once more connected with God, open our hearts to Him to hear His word today as He talks to us about good pain versus bad pain. Okay, let's pray. Lord Jesus, I just come bringing my 5 loaves and 2 fish to You to ask that You might take it and multiply it to meet the needs of Your people who have gathered here this morning. I just thank You for the privilege of sharing Your word with them. But now, Lord, we know that this is what we need in the face of a culture and a climate that does not necessarily know how to achieve harmony. And we pray that You would teach us, Your children, how to do it and what it may cost us, but that it's a good pain to do it. Lord, just let us move more fully to Your value system today as we hear Your word. Speak, Lord, Your servants are listening. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, for those who don't know the story, Jacob was the second born son of twins, fraternal twins, and the Bible describes him, the word that the actual Hebrew uses is soft. He was soft. And we kind of know what that implies. Jacob was kind of a mama's boy, where Esau looked like Ray Lewis. He was constructed. Broad shoulders, he was a hairy guy, and we've seen hairy guys, he was a hairy guy. And he loved the outdoors, he loved to hunt, and his dad kind of favored Esau, where his mom favored Jacob. And Jacob kind of hung around the house and learned to cook, and Esau was out hunting all the time. Anytime he could get outside to hunt, he was out hunting. And the time came when in the Jewish household, when a father would lay his hands on the firstborn and convey the inheritance to them. And that's a little different from the way we do it. We usually wait until the parent dies for a will to be opened. But in Jewish culture, you did that before you died. You passed on your inheritance to your children. And It would come with a hand being laid upon you and a blessing being conferred to you, and as the firstborn, you would get a double portion. Now, God had told Isaac and Rebekah that the older child will serve the younger child. So they had actually been given this message back before these kids were born, that the older will serve the younger. So that meant Esau would serve Jacob. But, gosh, Dad really liked the man that his son Esau had become. And so as the time grew near, as Jacob was growing weaker, his eyes had grown dim, he couldn't see well, he was ready to convey the firstborn blessing upon Esau. And when Jacob and Rebekah saw that, they said, we've got to get that blessing. We don't want that given to Esau. Mom wants that blessing given to the son that's closest to her. And so she and her son came up with a plot to fix some stew and go and give it to Papa. And after that stew, pretend you're Esau. And they did some really crazy things to kind of pretend that he was Esau. Would be the equivalent of going out and rolling in the grass to kind of get the smell of the earth on him and putting a goat skin on his arms so that when he felt it, he felt hairy. All in an effort to convince Isaac that Jacob was Esau and to put his hand on his head and to give him the firstborn blessing. Ripping his brother off. So they do it. Isaac is suspicious, but not so suspicious that he doesn't ultimately do that. He eats the stew that Jacob fixes him, saying he's Esau, and then puts his hand on his head and conveys the firstborn blessing. And as soon as that happens, and Esau comes home from his hunt, and he's got some food ready for Dad, and Dad finds out that it wasn't Esau that he laid his hand on, Esau is absolutely red in the face, snarling, angry, and says, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him. And he is plotting and planning Jacob's demise. And Jacob knows his time is short if he doesn't get out of the territory. So he runs. He runs and he runs and he runs. He runs all the way around the Fertile Crescent to a place called Haran, or near Haran. And when he gets there, God, as God often does, puts him with someone who is the king of ripoff artists, a guy named Laban, his uncle. And his uncle rips him off time after time after time for the next 21 years. All the while showing Jacob, kind of holding a mirror up to Jacob to give him a clear indication of just how it feels to be ripped off. Well, you come to chapter 32, and God has made it clear to Jacob that it's time to go home, but not just to go home to Canaan, but to go home and reconcile with your brother. And so we start chapter 32 with them on the journey. And it says in verse 1, as Jacob went on his way, the angels of God met him. And when he saw them, he said, this is God's camp. So he named the place Mahanaim, which means two camps. And that idea of two camps gets repeated throughout this passage. You'll see it if you were to read through it. I won't mention them all. I'm not going to read all the verses in this thing. But the idea of being two camps. So Jacob sees these angels say, it's God's camp and my camp. We're two camps. But then later on, there will be two camps when he divides his family. There will be two camps when he ultimately sees that his group is coming up against Esau's group. And that's the significance, I think, that God wants us to see here in the repetition of these two camps, that we have two divided bodies here, two camps that are at odds with each other, but that God's goal is that they reconcile.
So Jacob sends messengers in verse 3 to Esau to let him know that he's coming. And he commands them what they should say. And at the end of verse 6, we find the messengers return. And they say to Jacob, "We came to your brother Esau. And furthermore, he is coming to meet you." It would have been great if the period had been put right there. But messengers continued, "He is coming to meet you, and 400 men are with him." Jacob knew what that meant. Esau was coming with an army. Esau hadn't forgotten what his brother had done to him, hadn't forgotten his commitment and promise to kill him. Jacob knew what it meant. Verse 7. Then Jacob was greatly distressed, greatly afraid. And he divided his people who were with him and the flocks and the herds and the camels into two companies. Here are our two camps again. And he said, "If Esau comes to the one company, attacks it, the other company which is left will escape." And then he prays. So he freaks out first and kind of does some plotting and planning of his own. But then he decides, you know, maybe I ought to talk to God about this. And so he prays. And he says, "O Lord, O God of my father Abraham, God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who did say to me, 'Return to your own country and to your relatives, and I will prosper you. I am unworthy of all the loving kindness and of all the faithfulness which you have shown to me, to your servant. For with my staff only I crossed the Jordan, and now I have become two companies." Again, idea of two companies. "Deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he come and attack me, the mothers with the children. For thou didst say, 'I will surely prosper you and make your descendants as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude.'" So he spent the night there, and then we read kind of the details of what he does, how he divides them up into two companies, and then he starts sending out groups of different animals ahead of them, camels and goats and sheep and cattle. And so he keeps sending these groups out in front of the families who are coming, and he tells them exactly what they're to say. If Esau says, "Who are you and where do you come from?" "I am from your servant Jacob, and this is a gift for my lord Esau." And each group that he came across, that was what those who were driving the livestock were to say, that this is a gift for my lord Esau. And what Jacob is doing is, again, having ripped off his brother, he realizes that one of the things I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to make some restitution here. And so he is making restitution, sending gift after gift after gift after gift. Well, this kind of conflict, this kind of stress, this kind of division between brethren often creates this kind of stomach acid that Jacob is experiencing, especially when you know you're going to have to go and face him, face the individual that you've wounded or that you've hurt or that you've ripped off or that you've said things about or that, however it's happened, if you know you have to go, the prospect of facing that individual having done what you've done produces all sorts of inner conflicts. Now, sometimes we'll just sit with that stuff. And it can chew on us. I remember the conflicts I was having in my church in Toronto. It had gotten so bad, I literally had people that sat in the choir behind me on Sunday morning, and they would sit there with their arms folded, glaring at anybody who looked like they were enjoying their worship. I mean, that's just kind of the attitude in my church. They were angry. They were angry at me. We had two funds, missions fund and a general fund. I was paid out of the general fund, and as time went on in that church, people who usually gave their tithe to the general fund switched it all to the missions fund because they didn't want to have their money going to pay me. So this is how conflicted it was becoming in my church. I began to preach series of messages. One I remember called Holy Discontent. That was H-O-L-Y, discontent, but it was really reflective of my own heart, which was W-H-O-L-L-Y, discontent. I preached another series called Wart Removal for the Church. So you can imagine kind of the attitude I had and the idea of whatever I had to do to make things right, I preferred escape. I started to look to leave. I wanted to get out of there. Because for most of us, that's preferable. We'd rather escape than figure out how to reconcile or resolve this thing. Jacob could have fled at this point. He could have run. Could have turned, said maybe life with Laban wasn't so bad. Turned right around and gone back to Haran. But he didn't. And that's why I believe this story is in the Bible. Jacob sent his family across the river. Verse 22, that same night he arose that same night, took his two wives and his two maids and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. And he took them and he sent them across the stream, and when he sent them, and he sent across whatever he had. So he then was left alone, verse 24. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. He prays, he plans, he sends gifts and restitution. But then tomorrow he knows he's going to have to look his brother in the eye that he ripped off. And he knows he's going to have to take responsibility for what he's done. And the night before he has to do that, a lot of people in churches who've been around church for a while know the story of Jacob wrestling with the angel. What they often don't know or forget is the context for why he's wrestling with that angel, which is God making it absolutely crystal clear that he has to go and reconcile. Ever been there? Ever been in that place where God is making it clear that you've got to go, that you've done something that you need to make right, and you've got to go, and you've got to take words with you, as he says in Hosea. You've got to take words with you and say what you need to say, take responsibility. I remember I was at a, this is when God was working in my heart after that kind of ugly time in my church. God had begun to work in my heart and started to do just a lot of what he was doing in Jacob here and just kind of revealing my own sin to me and kind of my own attitudes and how they were wrong. And I remember in the midst of that, one of the churches nearby my church in Toronto held a prayer conference. And so I went to this prayer conference. It was for Christian leaders, so a lot of pastors came to this prayer conference. They had some highly significant guys that were coming to speak. And I remember going to that prayer conference and sitting there. And I remember one of the men who came and spoke, not on this passage, but on the importance of reconciliation in the context of Christian. If Christians want to be heard before God, they've got to have their hearts right with each other. Jesus said, leave your offering, go make your, if you've got something against your brother has something against you, leave your offering, go make it right, then come back and make your offering. That's what makes it acceptable. You can't have broken relationships at this level and expect everything to be hunky-dory here. Now, if you know anything about Toronto historically, especially back in the 90s, there was a thing called the Toronto Revival. And the Toronto Revival was an unusual experience, or it was called the Toronto Airport Revival, various labels for it. If you didn't hear about it, don't worry, I'll tell you about it real quick. For The impact that it had, it was astounding. It was at the international airport, and people literally flew from all over the world to come to this revival. But for the pastors who were in the city of Toronto, it was just flat out weird. In fact, we not so affectionately called it the barnyard, because in this supposed revival, people would roar like lions, cluck like chickens, bark like dogs. They would get down on all fours while the service was going on with these manifestations. They had healings and they had other things, but there was all this cacophony of noise that was occurring while this purported revival was taking place. And so we weren't real keen on it. Well, a bunch of the people from the Toronto Revival came to this prayer conference. And the leaders of the prayer conference made it clear that we are across a lot of denominational lines here at this conference. So we're going to ask you to leave your kind of preferable way of worship out in the parking lot and just join and let us lead the worship and not express yourself as you might normally in your church. Well, that was hard for some of these people from the Toronto Revival. But they tried to behave themselves. But one of the announcements that was made was for pastors in particular, if you would like to pray next or tomorrow morning for the revival or for what God is doing in our midst, come at 6:30. Conference starts at 8:30. We're going to meet at 6:30 and pray for things. And right then the Holy Spirit said, I want you to go. I said, okay. Kind of, you know, feeling that prompting of the Holy Spirit. I want you to go. And I want you to take responsibility for your attitude towards your Pentecostal and charismatic brethren. I'm not charismatic. I'm not Pentecostal. And I always tended to look down on those who were as being kind of hyper-emotional. And I want to give no offense. You're going to hear how this story ends. So if you are, then forgive me up front, because I will resolve and reconcile this thing. But at that point, I had real issues. And again, a lot of it was with the stuff related to the revival. But again, I was with a lot of guys that, you know, expressed their worship very different from me, very, very what I considered out of control. And God says, I want you to go to that pastor's prayer meeting tomorrow morning, and I want you to take responsibility for your attitude. And I said, God, don't make me do that. Don't make me do that. I don't want to do that. And so I remember walking out of the prayer conference that evening thinking, that sounded like the voice of God, but it might not have been. It might have been the pepperoni pizza I had at lunch, you know, that was kind of, you know, doing things in my belly. And so I went home that night, and the pressure on my heart remained. I woke up early the next morning, set my alarm, woke up early, and went out and had my quiet time. And all through my quiet time, the Holy Spirit was saying, I want you to go, I want you to go, I want you to go. And it was like, so I did. I went. Got there at 6:30. There were about 25 pastors. And I sat down, and I literally sat there with my hands folded in my lap. And these brothers and sisters who were in that meeting manifested every stereotype I had of them. They were, some of them got down, were rolling on the floor, and they were babbling, and they were these hyper-emotional prayers. And I'm just sitting there. And God is saying, tell them. Tell them. I said, but Lord, look at them. And he says, what they are and what they're doing is my responsibility. Your responsibility is your attitude. Tell them. Well, 1 hour and 15 minutes went by. And I couldn't do it. The prayer meeting ended, and I sat there after everybody left, totally defeated. I knew I had not done what I was supposed to do. So the prayer conference finished up, but out of that, a group of pastors that I did fellowship with regularly decided that it would be good to have a concert of prayer. And so they arranged this, and got our church was invited, so it was going to be at the largest Pentecostal church in Toronto. And the week of that concert of prayer, the guy that was the head of it called me. He says, the fellow who was supposed to speak and bring the devotional has just canceled, can't come. He says, would you do it? And as soon as he said it, the Spirit of God gripped my heart and he said, gotcha. What you were unwilling to do before 25, you must now do before 1200. So the night of the concert of prayer, there were 1,200 people in that auditorium. And I stood up, and I'm not a crier, you know, but I could barely keep control as I said, you know, I'm standing before you all today, and God has made something very clear to me, that I cannot say or do anything else before I take responsibility for attitudes that I've had toward my Pentecostal and charismatic brothers and sisters. I have thought and I have felt things about you that are ungodly and unworthy of a Christian. And I'm standing before you today asking if you would somehow find it in your heart to forgive me. Well, the guy whose church it was, Pentecostal pastor behind me, Assembly of God pastor, jumped up, came running to the platform, put his arms around me. He says, brother, I forgive you. He says, I got to confess something to you. He says, I have felt that way about non-Pentecostal people. He says, I feel like I've often thought they were second-class Christian citizens. And he says, you got to forgive me. And then the other guys that were sitting on the platform, about seven of us, all kind of came up and surrounded. And so what I feared and dreaded and wrestled with God over, once accomplished, bad pain became good pain. That is what Jacob is doing. He knows he's got to face his brother tomorrow. And he is wrestling with God. And we know the story. If you're familiar with your Bibles, if you're not, it's a great story. It says, verse 24, Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. And when he saw that he had not prevailed against him, that's interesting. So this angel of the Lord, whom Jacob comes to realize this man is, he touched the socket of his thigh. So the angel is realizing he has not prevailed against Jacob. And with his finger, he touches Jacob's thigh. It takes almost a sledgehammer to knock your thigh out of socket. The angel does it with a touch. Knocks Jacob's thigh socket out, so he was dislocated while he wrestled with him. Then he, the angel, said, let me go, for the dawn is breaking. But Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be rip-off artist, but Israel, striver with God, or prince of God. for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." And then Jacob asked and said, "Please tell me your name." And he says, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And he blessed him there. So Jacob named the place Peniel, for he says, and that's the Hebrew for the face of God, "I have seen God face to face, yet my life has been preserved." So he wrestles with God. God knocks his socket, the thigh, out of its socket. And what God says is that Jacob beat me in this wrestling match. Because God always wants to lose when it comes to us wrestling with him for blessing. We may have to do something to get that blessing, something that we may not have wanted to do. But if we're willing to do it, God will bless us, no matter how difficult the wrestling match has been to get there. Verse 31, "Now the sun rose upon him, and he, as he crossed over Penuel, and he was limping on his thigh." One of the reasons I think God did that is so that Jacob would know it was not a dream. Your hip isn't going to get knocked out of socket during a dream. It was not a dream. This happened to him. And then we read in verse 30, or chapter 33, how he reconciles with Esau. That's how much God values reconciliation between brothers and sisters. This whole story exists to tell us that. So if Jacob were here today, and I had a microphone I could put up to his mouth, and I said, "Jacob, saw you limp up here onto the platform. You know the price that it cost you to do what you did. If you had it to do over again, would you do what you did? Would you go reconcile with Esau if you knew you were going to have to walk with a limp the rest of your life?" And I think Jacob would look at us and go, "Absolutely. Absolutely. It was worth it. It is worth it." Stomach acid, stress, fear, anxiety, all beforehand. But afterwards, all that becomes good pain. Good pain. So, you got anybody out there that God is saying, "Leave your offering here. Go make things right with your brother, with your sister. Do not live with it any longer." You may be saying, "Oh God, I hope it's the pepperoni pizza I ate that's putting this conviction on my heart." But I can tell you it didn't. You do that, and you'll get to see God in a way you've never seen him before. That's what you get as a benefit. And it's worth walking with a limp the rest of your life to get it. Let's bow together for prayer. Challenging truth, Lord, challenging truth, because you know the paths that some of us have walked. You know the challenges that we have faced in our life. So, Lord, if there's someone here who knows that they're hearing your voice, you're squeezing their heart, they know that there's somebody or a group that they're going to have to go and take responsibility for attitudes or actions or neglect that they know has been hurtful. Do that, Lord, and out of unity, would you bring harmony in this body and to whomever in whatever context these relationships exist. And may your church feel the impact of that powerfully and wonderfully. Do this, Lord. Redeem the pain and make it good pain, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.